Nama saya Nelly Julan Apuy. Saya seorang penyanyi. Dari kecil saya memang minat menganyam. Saya belajar sendiri, berusaha sendiri macam mana ini boleh jadi. Semua anyam-anyaman saya mau coba. Apa yang mak buat saya tengok. Dia tidak pernah juga ajar. Sekali dia tengok apa yang sudah siapkan, dia mengkritik. Baru sekarang saya tahu yang mak ajar dulu kan, yang mana salah, yang mana betul. Oh, patut lemak. Arwah mak cakap macam itu dulu. Ini asas anyam tu ada mengkuang, rotan, lemban, dan semua itu ada di kampung. Kami pakai barang ni hari-hari kan, pakai bawa padi di kebun mau ambil sayur apa kan, memang anyam juga dah. Mula-mula kami orang datang dari kampung kan, pergi Batu Nias sana. Saya punya suami kerja, anak mas saya Tedika. Sementara tunggu di Tedika, saya buat minuman di kaki lima tu. Sekali ada orang limpas, dia orang tepah. Saya target tu siap. At least saya terima sedikit untuk anak saya. Jadi saya yang belanja semua keluarga. Saya tu memang dia banyak tolong ya, karena dia yang pertama di order dengan saya banyak itu. Ya bayar deposit dulu, pakai duit ini saya boleh beli lagi bahan dan saya buat untuk orang lain. Dia faham keadaan orang miskin, especially di Sasi. Saya anggap dia macam tempat saya mengadu. Tempat saya apa masalah. Sasi kata yang orang lebih suka lagi kerja ada quality. Daripada you buat banyak-banyak tapi tidak ada quality, tidak orang mau beli. Saya dengar apa yang dia ajar saya kan, saya pun apply to orang lain. Orang kampung harus pandai anyam. Tapi orang muda macam tidak minat lagi. Kalau semua orang tua ni meninggal, siapa yang buat benda itu lagi? Mudah-mudahan saya sehat dan saya akan buat desain yang orang mau sekarang. Mesti saya mau buat yang terbaik untuk mereka.
Ladies and gentlemen, I would like to welcome Miss Sashi. Please do take. I'm gonna stop sharing now.
Okay, hold on. Let me try and share my window here. There we go. Okay. Hi, everyone. My name is Sasi. I don't know how to... I guess people can't really see me, right? Is there a way to show me speaking and the screen at the same time?
Can you turn on your video cam? Is it? I think we can see you at the same time. Watch the EV recording as well. Thank you.
There we go. Can people see me and the
yes, presentation? You. Okay. Thank you.
Okay. So let me go into presentation mode. Okay. Hi everyone. My name is Sasi. I'm the founder of Earth Air. And Earth Air was actually founded in 2013. So today I just wanted to share with all of you a little bit about my journey into why I started Earth Air. So that's one of the key questions that I get asked very often is when I speak to young people at universities, I always get asked, why did you leave your corporate finance investment banking job to start a social business, right? So to do that, I wanted to maybe just share a little bit about my personal history, which would hopefully help you understand why I did what I did. So I was born in Malaysia. I was born in Ipoh, and my grandfather came to Malaysia in the early 1900s, during the British colonial time. So my father was born here in Malaysia, and I was born here. So I'm second generation Malaysian. Because of the fact that our family has very close ties to my grandparents' relatives, and in India, so we used to go and spend a lot, like some of our summer holidays in India, visiting my parents. And it was during that time that I really understood, or I saw for myself at a young age, what poverty was. Because growing up in Peninsular Malaysia, in Ipoh and KL, we have access to water, electricity. Even if we had, live a basic lifestyle, you have basic amenities. And it was very eye-opening for me to see that many other people around the world do not have the basic things that we take for granted, or the things that we may complain about. I mean, case in point, the fact that we didn't have water, 1.2 million people didn't have water over the weekend. It was such a huge convenience, but millions of people, if not billions around the world, live without access to water. So it made me realize at that age that this idea of difference, and this idea of lack, that not everyone has the same life. And as I grew up and seeing that in my life, I felt that there was more that I should be doing, and there's more that I could be doing. So when I was 13, I went to study in Singapore, because back then, when I was 13, you could not study in English if you went to a normal government school in Malaysia. International schools did not allow Malaysians to study in them. So did my primary school in Malaysia, and then my secondary school, I actually did it in Singapore. And when I was 16 years old, I went to India, and one of my grand uncles passed away, and I began to see that it really affected me at that point, because he was someone that I cared deeply about, and he had worked his whole life in Malaysia, sent money back to his family in India, and in his old age, his family did not take care of him, so he passed away quickly. And then, so it was kind of like a turning point for me when that happened. Then I decided that whatever it is that I did with my life, from that point onward, would be to make a difference in the lives of others. So I went to the US to study when I was 17, and the Wharton School is known for finance. So I wanted to study geology or archaeology, but my father, as an Asian parent, very responsibly said that I study finance. So I studied finance. And when I graduated from university, most of the Wharton graduates usually worked in New York. You either work with a management consulting firm or with an investment banking firm. So I chose Lehman because the team that I met there were the most friendly and helpful. That's kind of how I made my decision. So I started working at Lehman 2000, and that was just before, I mean, the year before September 11th happened. So I left New York when September 11th happened, and the only Malaysian that died in September 11 was one of my high school friends, Shankar. So Shankar and I were both like young 21-year-olds working in New York, working long hours, getting very well paid for a 21-year-old. And one day he was working late and the next day he was gone. So to me, this was sort of the second situation in my life where I had lost someone I cared about. And it made me realize that life really is ephemeral. We don't know when we will no longer be on this earth. So, you know, these thoughts were in my mind as they had. And so I actually left Lehman after a year of working there. My program, the analyst program, was actually 2 years, but I left halfway because I wanted to do a master's. So I did my master's at Cambridge University, and my master's was in environment and development because I wanted to understand why is there poverty if there is so much abundance in the world? You know, why do we have poor people when there's clearly more than enough money, right? And there's more than enough food. But what's happening that it's causing all of these issues? So I did my master's and I did my thesis actually on microfinance because I admired Muhammad Yunus, whom you may or may not have heard of Grameen Foundation and Grameen Bank. And after my master's, I actually wanted to work in Africa because that was my dream to work in Africa. But surprisingly, getting a job in Africa or with an NGO in Africa was much harder than getting a job with an investment bank in New York. So I actually came back to Malaysia and I worked for 2 years in a company. And then when I was 25, I got the opportunity to do an internship at the UNDP. So I actually borrowed money from my parents, packed up my bags and flew to Accra, Ghana, and lived there for 2 years. So I initially worked with the UN, UNDP, and then I found a job as an expatriate living in Ghana, working with communities affected by gold mining companies. So I don't know how many of you know this, but Ghana actually got independence the same year as Malaysia in 1957. So they often compare themselves to us. And Ghanaians and Nigerians actually say that we got our palm oil from West Africa, which is true. And so they say, you know, look at what Malaysia has done with the palm oil business or industry and look at where West Africa is. Anyway, so I left Ghana after 2 years because I paid off my student loans and I kind of ran out of money. So I went back to London and I was actually trying to look for a job in a financial institution, like a development institution, like a consulting firm that would be similar to what I was doing in Ghana. But unfortunately, I didn't find a job with a development firm, but I found a job with a hedge fund, and private equity fund advisory firm. So I learned about private equity funds and hedge funds, and I was in London for 2 years. So as you can see, as I was getting towards the age of 30, I started thinking a lot more about what am I doing in my life, you know, because as you know from my childhood, I was very concerned about issues concerning other people, like poverty. But then my career was very much focused on finance, right? So it's like one side of my life is about making money and making a lot of money. And the other side of my life is my desire and sincere passion to want to make a difference. So I didn't feel that either of these business models work because working with an NGO, you're constantly like struggling for money, you're constantly looking for donations to try and keep doing the good that you do. And then when you work with a capital driven corporation, you have a lot of money, but you're not always thinking about how to do good. So that's really how initially in my mind this whole idea of social business came about, because then I was thinking, why can't we keep making money to keep doing the good that we do so that it's self-sustainable and it's sustaining on its own? So I came back to Malaysia when I was 30, and I was working with Khazanah National. I worked with Khazanah for about 2 years, two and a half, almost 3 years. And I quit because I almost got into a car accident because I was working really, really long hours, and I fell asleep while I was driving. So I decided at that point that if I was going to die, that I want to make sure that I have lived a life that I believe in and that my life has been impactful. And this photo here is actually a photo of my father. He passed away last year. I just wanted to, you know, share the photo of him, because the reason why I'm doing what I'm doing is really because of my father and the values that he taught me and the way that he lived his life of service, of generosity. Actually, he was the one who would always ask me, he's like, why are you running Earth Air? You know, you're making peanuts. Why are you wasting your life? You know, you should continue working with Khazanah so you can earn lots of money. But I think towards, you know, after a few years of Earth Air, I think he understood why I'm doing it, because it really made me happy to feel like I was applying my life for the good of others, and doing what I can to make a difference. So I kind of wanted to share a little bit about the process that I went through. So when I left Khazanah, I started thinking about these questions, about what does it actually mean to live a purpose-driven life? You know, how can I live an impactful life? So when I was going through this, this period, I actually spoke to a lot of different people in my life, like other entrepreneurs, friends who started businesses. I was reading a lot, and I actually took time off to go Hawaii. I wanted to learn more about God. I wanted to learn about natural farming. And then I was in Cambodia, building schools, teaching English. And in fact, it was while I was in Cambodia that in a way the idea for Earth Air started, because I met with a lot of communities and sex trafficking survivors. I met a lot of poor communities that were really, really struggling with selling their products. And so I just started buying products that they had and started selling them, right? And so one of my friends actually said, look, Sasi, you should think about what is your personal mission statement. And I was like, what, why should I write a personal mission statement for myself? And he said, if you write a personal mission statement for yourself, then you will be able to decipher whether a path before you aligns with your mission statement. So I did that. And I wrote down a simple, I think it's a 2-page guide. So if anybody in this group would like a copy of that, I'd be happy to send it to Farah and she can share it with you guys. So I wrote my personal mission statement, and this is what mine is. So I wrote this after almost 3 or 4 months of thinking about it and going through many different iterations. So this defines the core values that I believe in as a human being, that people and the environment should be treated with respect. And that is reflected in the name Earth Air as well. So the concept is that all of us are heirs of this earth, and we have a responsibility to care for the people and for the environment. So I feel very deeply led by this responsibility that for us to exist in this world, we should be a positive contribution to this, to the world, both environmentally and both socially. And that is also what has inspired Earth Air's vision as a company. So for us, it's very much about everything that we do is to help our artisans, the people that we work with, the consumers, or clients that we work with, is for people to understand this value, that we should be a reflection of being heirs of this earth. So after being in Cambodia, you know, speaking to my friends, writing my mission statement, I met with a impact investor who's sort of like a mentor, and he actually said, if you want to help these women that you're meeting, this cannot be a hobby. You have to make it a business so that you can keep making money to keep helping these women. So these were the issues that I saw. You know, a lot of these women were, and the artisans that we were working with didn't have enough money. They were not making enough money because middlemen that they worked with made most of the margins. And they didn't have access to international markets. They were not sophisticated enough to do that. And then because of that, all of these traditional heritage crafts were dying. And, you know, I was like, what can I do, right? So I started buying the products, and it became very clear to me that we cannot just be another middleman, right? Maybe we are an ethical middleman, but we can't just be another middleman. So it became very clear to me that the solution that we are going to create has to be one that is focused on ethical business practice. It has to be a business that focuses on great design. Because one of the issues that I saw with the sector is that a lot of products made by traditional artisans were seen as like, oh, this is a village kampung product, you know, oh, the design looks so chachat or chaplang or whatever, and I don't want to buy it, you know, because it doesn't look good. Or people think that because it's made by a village community, it should be very cheap. And they don't actually respect the craftsmanship and the labor and the skills and the talent that went into the product. So that's why, to me, it was very important that Earth Air is a brand, that we created a brand that stands for something, a brand that has credibility. And Earth Air is now actually fair trade certified. So there's a certification called Fair Trade Certification, if you haven't heard of it. It's given the World Fair Trade Organization. So our business model is very much the screen that you see in front of you, is that, you know, we collaborate with the artisans. So we custom design the products. So the products that we have, you do not find in the market because they're designed by us and the artisans make them for us. Of course, you may find it if other people copy our designs. And a big part of our impact is actually training the artisans. So a lot of the artisans that we work with Orang Asli, with refugees, with differently abled artisans. So like disabled artisans, we also work with women prisoners, and we work with village women. So a lot of these communities that we work with have no idea what good design is or about consistency of design, you know, because they are very used to just making whatever they make, you know, and they're like, okay, I just make whatever and then I just sell it, right? fact that when we came in as a brand and we said, look, this is our design, this is a size, so we need you to make according to this size and follow the design, right? So initially it was very, very hard for the artisans because they're like, oh, you're making our life so difficult. Why must we follow this? You know, so they were just not used to producing or making products where there was a standard, where there were quality requirements. Before, no one had asked them for these things. So we actually worked for a very long time with the artisans, sometimes up to 2 years, to train the artisans on design, on quality, on pricing, on production, and how to plan their production so that they can meet deadlines. So, and as you may know, we sell the products on our website, earthair.com. We also have a physical space where people come and buy our products. And 10% of our profits are donated to other NGOs and to tree planting. Yeah, so sorry, I already mentioned the solutions that we're doing. So EarthAir is positioned, like I mentioned, I don't want the brand or the products that we have to be perceived as poorly designed, like trinkets, like tourist knickknacks that people just buy for a couple of bucks, right? Or the other end of this is that it can become a very high-end product that is meant for museums. So the souvenirs don't respect the craft. The high-end products respect the craft, but it's very hard for artisans to make a living out of that because how many museums will buy your products, right? Or buy your art pieces. So we felt that our positioning has to be one that is in the middle of that, where we are making well-designed, well-made products that are also affordable. And with our World Fair Trade Organization certification, one of the key things that we have always tried to do is to try and be transparent with our pricing. So an example is our Nelly product, Nelly bags, and it's sort of the average pricing breakdown of where the price goes to. So one of the questions that people have asked us is, if you're from Sabah or Sarawak, you've probably seen these bags before. And there are other NGOs that are selling similar bags for like 60, 70 ringgit, right? And one of our bags starts at 190. So we actually gave the pricing breakdown of where the cost goes to. So EarthAir is not an NGO. We do not get free labor. We do not get free volunteers. We do not get free anything, right? So we have to pay for everything. So we are running and building ourselves as a social business because to me, this is the long-term solution that will work because we are paying employees, we are paying the artisans, we are paying the shopping malls or departmental stores that are selling our products. They take a retail sales commission. So all of these things are the realistic costs of running a business. And this is what our breakdown is. So the fact that our margin is a pitiful 5% is actually very, very low for most retail brands. Like the luxury brands that you go out and buy, right? There are margins on their products. Most of their cost is in marketing and expensive retail locations. And you're being charged a margin of maybe 100%, 1,000% or a few 1,000% over the actual cost of the product. So these are some of our products. So what's innovative about these is that the product, our bags are actually made by 6 different groups in Malaysia. The body of the bag is made in Sarawak. The straps and handles are made in Selangor. All of the inner pouches are made by refugees in Selangor. And all of our leather zip pullers are made by a shoe factory in Klang. And our logo, the gold logo on the bag, is made by a company in Penang. So it was very important to us that we really sell and talk about the Made in Malaysia story. And these are some of our other products where, so we have a mix of natural fiber and the Nelly range of products, which is made out of plastic strips. So I think the Nelly range is probably the only product range that is not made out of natural fiber. So all of our other products are like mengkuang, ribu ribu, rattan. So they're all biodegradable and sustainable. So the only reason we decided to go ahead with the plastic strips is because rattan is getting very hard to source. And this plastic is very long lasting. So I've been using my bag, which I have, for more than 2.5 years, and it's still in great shape. So it's important to us that whatever we sell be long lasting products, because we're not for fast fashion. We are great supporters of slow fashion and encouraging people to buy less but buy well. Another project that we've also worked on in the last 3 years is working with refugees. This is a global project working with UNHCR, and we are the only social enterprise, social business that the UN is working with in Malaysia. So we've been making beautiful jewelry cross-stitched by the refugees, which is available on our website. And we actually worked with refugees from the Middle East, so Syria, Palestine, Afghanistan, Pakistan, and refugees from Myanmar. And I wanted to share this because, you know, a lot of people talk badly about refugees and how, you know, they think refugees here are here to suck up our money or live off of us. To be honest, the refugees are some of the hardest working people that I've met amongst our artisans, because they, like us, they just want to be able to support their families. They want to work hard. So during the MCO period, we made more than 24,000 pieces of PPE with refugees for Malaysian frontliners. So these PPE were stitched by refugees and we donated them to hospitals around Malaysia. This is our team. We're a very small team. It's actually kind of just the five of us. Puma and Yiling don't work in the business. They are non-executive. So people often think that, you know, we are like a big team with lots of people, but we're not. We're very lean, and we try to, you know, we have a great, great team and great familial spirit. It's very important to me that when I started that it has a very good culture that is respectful of people as individuals. And it's a culture where people can grow. So we now have customers around the world, and these are some of the main places that we have exported to and sold our products to. And this is some of our clients. A big project that we're working on right now is actually with Cellcom. So if you go to the Cellcom website, and you will see their campaign called Mereka Merdeka, which is making masks. So we're making almost 10,000 face masks for Cellcom, and you can purchase them on our website. So that is it for me. Okay.
Thank you so much. Thank you, Sashi. Let me share my screen as well. Right. So for students or for anyone who is here and would like to ask question to our lovely Miss Sashi over here, as you can see here, if you have any questions, you guys can scan this QR code or go to slido.com and then you can just simply enter this event code. Okay, so if you have any questions, you can scan this QR code and then you can enter this event code so that we can read your questions and we can ask Ms. Sashi. But while do that, we have a couple of questions already for you, Ms. Sashi. So so I think the first question that a lot of people do ask me, and I think a lot of my students also ask me, is that what are some of the challenges of doing social business or social enterprise itself in Malaysia? Because it's not something that is very widely known in Malaysia. So can you share some of the challenges that you guys that ever had?
I just wanted to answer the first question on Slido, which is related to this. This person said, how does your business survive if your aim of the business is not about making profit? I never said that. We are a social business. Our aim is very much to make profit so that we are sustainable. We're not an NGO. An NGO does not aim to make a profit, but we do. And we use our profits to keep the business sustainable. Okay, so this issue of sustainability and how do you balance profit with impact, right? So that's definitely not an easy equation. But for me, the first thing that I wanted to prove to myself was whether the social business model even works. So as a business, we didn't get any grants. We won the British Council Social Enterprise Award, and that gave us about 30,000 ringgit. And out of that 30,000, 25,000 was actually spent, it was spent towards renovating our studio space. And since then, we have not raised any external capital. Why? Because for me, it was very important to prove to myself that our business model actually works. Because if your business model does not work and we cannot survive on our own profits and our own revenues, then how can I tell other people that, you know, our business works? Because if our business was supported by a lot of grants, right? Because now what a lot of people do is they apply for grants, and a lot of tech startups, they get investors. So you get lots and lots of investors, give you capital, and then you build your business model, and then your business model may or may not work, right? So with tech startups example, which is why you have successful businesses, but you also have a lot of businesses that don't succeed because they don't even know their business model is going to work. So for me, it was very important that the business model was working, so we knew that we could make money. And of course, the ability to scale and the ability to break even and to be sustainable long term took a lot longer. I think with Earth Air, it took us almost 4 to 5 years to like be profitable, right? And that's not a runway time that everyone is able to go through. So for me personally, the first 3 years of Earth Air, I was not paying myself a salary, and I survived by doing consulting work to support myself. I was relying on my savings from my my banking days. So my advice to young people who may be thinking about a social business is definitely try working with someone else first, because I think that the work experience that I had before I started my social business was very crucial to build me up as a person to be able to handle the issues that I had with that. Because if you just start your business, of course, you know, I'm not saying that you can't be successful, you know, like Pitcher Project is a great example of young people who just got together and started something and are very successful, right? But not everyone will have the same experience. So my advice is go and work for someone else first, build up your skills, learn about work ethic, learn what it is, how does a normal business run? So you will learn this when you work with other people. And once you do that, you know, you can, if you decide to start your own social business, you can. So going back to the question about balancing the two, it is not an easy decision, as in, but for me, the guiding, what I used as my guiding compass was that we cannot do any harm. So whatever decision we make as a business cannot be doing any harm to the people that we're working with or the people that we are selling our products to. Or to, I mean, anyone that we're working with, no one should be harmed in the decisions that we make. So for example, it was very important that all the artisans that we worked with are paid fairly. So we do not compromise, we don't exploit any of the people that we work with. We have to make sure that they're paid fairly and they're paid a living wage. And that is also something that we have to do because we're fair trade certified and we're audited by international bodies to make sure that we are treating the artisans that we work with very well. And on top of that, it was very important to me that you know, the pricing that we are creating for our products obviously like needs to be a fair price. You're not going to buy you're not going to find Earth Air bags, like I mentioned earlier, you know, it costs 190, starts at 190 ringgit. Why are we not selling it at 50 ringgit? Because we are pricing the product as a business would. And that means you will have enough money to pay salaries of people, which includes me, and paying the artisans fairly, which pays for the marketing costs with the rent of our studio. I mean, it's all the things that you need to survive and to build a real business. So for the hardest thing about doing what we're doing, I think, has been like to build marketing and to build revenue and to build enough revenue for us to be able to sustain ourselves. And if you had spoken to me in the first 3 years of my journey at Earth Air, in August 2015, I was actually close to shutting down Earth Air. I told my family that I'm done. I've given this 3 years of my life and I can't do it anymore. And that was when I went to the US for the Eisenhower Fellowship. And I was very encouraged by the people that I met there, you know, and it gave me a new business revenue channel, which was B2B. So instead of just selling direct to end consumers, we started doing a lot of business and product sales to companies, to events, because universities like INTI, or I mean, like we made tote bags for the Wharton School. We made, you know, we're making face masks for Cellcom. So we make a lot of customized products for companies, for weddings. And this created a whole new revenue stream that helped our sustainability. So that's kind of how I look at balancing profit and impact. So the people side of things must never be compromised, but we must also be able to charge fairly for all our products and our services so that we can make sure that we're sustainable as a business.
Yes, thank you. I think some of them actually ask, and they say that it's very interesting that you would like to focus on craftsmanship, and they want to know, why do you choose, you know, craftsmanship? Why what makes you feel like it's so interesting about Tika Mengkuang and all those traditional Malaysian craft that makes you want to sell them to the world?
Okay, so for me, you know, I studied finance. I have no background in fashion or retail or design or crafts. I guess for me, it happened to be a sector that I was exposed to when I was trying to think about how to help. So this was when I was in Cambodia. And I saw weavers making beautiful silk scarves, and you know, they were so beautiful. Like, I could imagine that people in New York or Europe would pay quite a bit of money for them. You know, but the artisans were getting paid a pittance. And I thought, this is really unfair. I should try and help them. So I just started buying from them and selling it to my friends and family. And you know what? Initially, we start when we, the early years of Earth Air, we were working with artisans in Cambodia, Indonesia, Thailand, India. And then when we won the British Council award, they actually said, hey, Earth Air, we want you to create Malaysian products. And at that point, I hadn't worked with any Malaysian artisans because, to be honest, I really didn't think Malaysia had many artisans left, because I thought, oh, Malaysia, all we have is some batik and some songket. That's it, you know. And I was, in fact, an ignorant Malaysian, ignorant urban Malaysian. And when British Council said, go and create 5 new Malaysian products, I started traveling within Malaysia. And then I realized that, well, actually, Malaysia has artisans left, but they are in very, very small numbers. And Malaysian artisans actually need help. And then as we started doing that, a gap in the market became very apparent. So as a Malaysian who travels and buys gifts for friends and family when I travel, my options were mainly like Royal Selangor. And I had been buying so many Royal Selangor products that after a while, like, my friends didn't, you know, I can't give them another Royal Selangor product because they already had quite a few of them. So then the other option was go to Central Market. And then when I go to Central Market, half the products there are not even Malaysian. They are not even made in Malaysia. So it became very clear to me that, hey, you know what? I, as a Malaysian, I want to find Malaysian products that are made ethically, that are beautifully made, that tell a story, that are impacting communities in Malaysia, and it's made in Malaysia. You know, I realized that here's an opportunity to change the whole made in Malaysia, like, perception. Because people normally think of made in Malaysia as like, oh, it must be crappy, or must be like poorly made, or, you know, people don't think of the made in Malaysia, like, mark as something to be proud of. And so, you know, the whole idea of Earth Air took a new meaning for me and our team, because we felt like, hey, we want to educate Malaysians about what amazing heritage we have in our own country. You know, that we as Malaysians should be so proud of the heritage that we all of us share. We have such a multicultural country. Like, we have Malays, we have Indians, Chinese, we have Orang Asli. And all of these communities, each community has a specific beautiful heritage craft. Though I must say that with Indians, I have not found any Indian artisans that I can work with in Malaysia yet. I am Indian, but I haven't found any. So we're working with all the other communities in Malaysia except Indians. Yeah.
Maybe future projects.
Hopefully.
Thank you, Ms. Sashi. So since the beginning of your presentation, you mentioned and you shared with us a lot of your experiences, and not only in social business, but perhaps also in a lot of, like, finance background as well. So I consider you as an expert in social business, because I think that you have a lot of experience in that area. So as a university, INTI is also part of, you know, social center, and we actually wanted to create, like, a subject to introduce our students to social business. And we think that social business is one of the new trend in perhaps in future business field. So we want to ask your opinion, if we were to create, like, a course for social business, what are some of the key elements that we have to think about, maybe the important things that maybe that we don't know? And then from your firsthand experience, you think that these are the things that we have to address and we have to share with our students?
I think it's important to realize that There's many different definitions of a social business, and a good place to read and learn about that is actually on the MAGIC website. And there was actually a report done by the British Council about a year or two ago, where they did a study on the social enterprise landscape in Malaysia. I was just looking at some of the questions, and one of the questions was whether there's enough support for social businesses in Malaysia. So I think, you know, when I started Earth Air in 2013, no one had an idea of what social enterprise was. And in fact, there was no one talking about it. There was no one helping me. There was, it was like a novel concept. And I even had some clients who were very suspicious about what we were doing, because they were like, hey, if you're helping people, how can you make money? You shouldn't make money. If you're helping people, you should be helping them. You cannot make money out of helping people, right? So there was a mistrust of the whole social business model itself. And I think now, 7 years later, there's definitely a lot more support. I mean, MAGIC exists. Even the Ministry of Entrepreneur Development is, you know, really looking at supporting social enterprises. There are a lot of new sort of benefits that have been given to social enterprises. I mean, when Prime Minister Najib was in power, he actually said they wanted to encourage all the government ministries to procure from social enterprises. So that hasn't really happened. But one of the things that has happened in the last year for us is that Earth Air is now a certified social enterprise, and we have been able to get tax exemption from the Income Tax Department. So what that means is not that we don't have to pay taxes on our profits or anything, but people who donate to us, donate to Earth Air, can get tax exemption receipts. So in the same way that you may give money to an NGO, you can give money to Earth Air and you'll get a tax exemption receipt. So this was very new to us, because, you know, we had never accepted any donations before because we're not an NGO. But then during the MCO period, when we were making PPE, we actually raised more than 200,000 ringgit from the general public and from corporations who gave us money, and we used that money to make PPE for the frontliners. So we don't normally accept donations, like, you know, just for no reason. You know, we will only accept donations for a specific cause or a campaign that we're hosting. Yeah. So I think the situation for social businesses is a lot better. When I started, there was only BGBG, Earth Air, Epic Homes, Batik Boutique, Tanoti. You know, I could count in one hand the number of social businesses in Malaysia. But then now there's probably hundreds of social businesses. And like I said, depending on your definition of social business, the British Council actually estimated that there was, I think, 10 or 20,000 social businesses in Malaysia. So I think one key thing to understand is the different business models. That's very key. And of course, I think understanding that, you know, as a entrepreneur, you know, starting a business and you have to make money to cover your costs. And running a social business is even harder, because not only do you have to make money to support yourself and make sure your business is sustainable, you also have to make sure that all the people you're working with, like the artisans, are being treated well, you are measuring your impact, you know. So it's like you have the social burden and social hat on top of the profit hat. So it makes it harder for your business to be sustainable and to be successful, which is why in the social business world, there's a very high attrition rate. A lot of the social businesses that I mentored with Magic, when I was mentoring with Magic, a lot of them don't exist anymore. So it's definitely not an easy sector to be in. But to me, you know, now 7 years later, we are self-sustaining, we are a profitable business. It took a long time to get here. But a lot of times people don't see the behind the scenes and the pain that it took to get to where you are today. You know, the early years when I didn't have enough money and I would be crying in the toilet about how I was going to pay off my credit card bills or pay our suppliers, you know. So I think a normal business, so one of the questions was, someone asked, do I think that social business should be the model going forward for businesses? Yes, I really do. I think that I actually am very tired of a lot of companies, I will not name any, but a lot of companies where for them, being socially responsible is like their corporate responsibility. So at the end of the year, they have a 1 million ringgit budget and they do something with it. So it's like, okay, let's go paint an orphanage or let's buy some food for this community. It's like it is not intrinsic in their business model. For me, every single business in Malaysia should be looking at their business model. That means like, how am I making money? Do I sell paper? Fine, I'm selling paper. But where is my paper being sourced from? You know, is it from sustainable forests? Am I killing the environment and killing the planet with my paper? Or is my paper socially responsible? You know, and how am I treating all the stakeholders in my business, my employees, my clients, my vendors? You know, do I have fair business practices? So I think thinking about social business should be part of the business model and not something that is like done at the end of like, you know, the year. Like it's not the DNA of the business. So I think there are a lot more companies that are starting to think about this and have done a lot. And I think multinational companies have definitely thought about this, and they're also some great examples of Malaysian companies that have done a lot of good. But I think, you know, MCO and everything, it definitely changed people's perceptions because, you know, it's kind of, people started thinking more about cost rather than the impact. But then it's also, I feel like there are also a lot of people during MCO that started thinking about the impact of their actions, you know, like where is the money that I'm spending going to, you know, and why should I buy something that's made by X, Y, and Z, or should I buy something that is made in Malaysia, supporting a local community, reducing a carbon footprint, growing the Malaysian economy, right? It's like, am I going to be bound by brands or what I perceive to be something that's branded, or am I going to be looking at quality of a product, you know?
Yeah.
So it's thinking about all of these things and becoming a more conscious consumer is what I hope Earth Air has been able to help educate our clients about, and also to help people ask questions about why they do what they do.
Yeah. Can we have two more questions before we end the session? I think, like you said, it's very, very not easy, considering that social business was not something that is very common back then when you first started. So what exactly are your motivations and, you know, your motivation, and what keeps you going every single day to do this?
Sorry, I just wanted to ask one question. Someone asked, yes, if people could get tax exemptions by donating to Earth Air or NGOs, aren't many of them going to be looking for loopholes to exploit the system? There is no loophole.
That's a good question there.
There is no loophole, because if you're donating to Earth Air, you get a tax exemption receipt in your Borang BE, which I don't know if any of you have paid income taxes yet, you can only claim up to, I think, 600 ringgit. You can only claim a certain amount to deduct from your tax. So it's not like you can donate 1 million ringgit and then get a tax, you know, and get your whole 1 million tax deductible. Yeah. You can't do that. So there's no loophole in that respect. And for the organization that is certified, we are audited by the Internal Revenue Board, right? Mm-hmm. So as you may or may not know, LHDN is not a easy, you know, they audit very rigorously before they give anyone the tax exemption status. Sorry. So your question, Tara, was about...
Your motivation that keeps you going every single day to do this, as you mentioned, it's not very easy.
I mean, I won't say the motivation was constant. It definitely changed and evolved. But in the one motivation I would say that hasn't changed is my deep desire to leave a good legacy, right? So for me, it was about if I'm going to wake up in the morning and get out of my bed, that whatever I do that day, I want it to be for something that I believe in and is changing someone else's life. You know, it's not about building castles and a big house and lots of cars for myself. So that was a decision that I made when I left Khazanah. I told myself that the kind of life that I want, the kind of life that I would be proud of if I die tomorrow, is a life where I feel like I have made a difference, and I know I have made a difference in other people's lives. And that's really what keeps me going. And that's what, you know, and then when I meet people like Kat Nelly, whose video you saw, you know, and the artisans that we work with, right? And the impact that we've made. Earth Air has sort of, you know, grown the understanding of Malaysian heritage crafts in Malaysia. Before we came along, no one really knew much about Malaysian. I mean, we knew, but there was no brand. There wasn't anyone talking about our Malaysian heritage and why it's important to keep it going, and you know, and the social businesses that like Tanuti, like Batik Boutique, you know, Tanuti works with Songkit and Batik Boutique works with Batik. It's like all these different social businesses have created brands and they've created a story. They've created businesses that are really taking forward Malaysian heritage crafts. So, you know, to feel like I have contributed to that, to feel like I have, you know, through Earth Air, that we have helped build a greater understanding and awareness of Malaysian heritage, of helping Malaysians be proud of who we are. I am so sick and tired of the politicians who keep trying to split us by our race. Malay, Indian, Chinese, refugee, orang asli, right? It's like they are playing the race card. But what I hope, you know, we get to build and help people understand is that we Malaysians have a shared heritage. We're all part of this nation. You know, we are all waris bumi ini. So it's like we should be working together for Malaysia, not working against each other.
I think that's very beautiful and very well said. Maybe the last question that we have here, because I see the students are actually quite, you know, curious about getting financial support or grants. If you know any kind or any places or any sources that we can actually apply for financial support or grants, how can we get financial supports or grant to start our social business?
So this is why I said work for someone else first. I am not a fan of like just looking for grants to start a business where you don't even know your business model will work, and then getting a lot of grants and then funding your social business, and then it doesn't work and then it's all wasted, right? Or so for me, because I invested my own personal savings into the business, I worked really hard to make sure that this business was successful. And I'm not saying that, you know, you shouldn't look for grants or capital from external capital. It's a very smart business move, right? Is to get grants and to get funds. But your motivation for making, you know, of trying to make something work may not be as much as if you had your personal money invested. So if you believe in what you're doing, put your money where your mouth is. So so I highly encourage young people to work, save money, actually learn what it is to work for someone else, build the discipline, work ethic, save money, and then build a business. But if you are looking for grants, so it's harder to come by now, but in earlier, I think around like 2015, 2016, like Magic was giving out a lot of grants, right? Mm-hmm. And a lot of the grants given out to a lot of social enterprises, like I said, don't exist anymore. So the funding and grants pipeline is now no longer very strong. So I know for fresh social businesses, if you want to start a business, it's not very easy to look for money. So if you can't get free money, what do you do? Come up with a business plan and a business model that works, that makes you money, so that you can keep building what you're doing. That is how traditional businesses do it, right? Traditional businesses, like, don't get free money. You have to go and get a bank loan. You have to pay that money back. So for me, that's what I think people should do. I think this whole like free money business has created this you know, situation where a lot of people don't realize how difficult it is to actually make money, and then they get free money and then, you know, it doesn't work out and all that money is just burned. So if you don't want that to happen, you would be focusing on making sure that your business model works and investing as much as yourself into your business. And if you can invest your own money so that you are personally invested in making that idea work.
True. Thank you so much. I think that you are a very true person. I think that we all learn a lot from you. I think that we all should be someone like a Malaysian like you, and we are deeply very honored to have you here with us today. So thank you so much, Sashi. Thank you so much again for your help and for your story to, you know, tell everyone. And I think for design thinking students especially, you touch a lot on a few things that we will be learning in our journey of design thinking, which includes business model canvas and all those things. So thank you so much again. Thank you again for coming and joining with us. And to all of the students, thank you for coming and thank you for listening. So go check out Earth Air. It's so beautiful, it's so great, and thank you everybody for coming. I hope that you guys learn a lot about social business. If you have any questions, please do ask your lecturers. Thank you. Let's thank Miss Sashi, everyone in the chat box. Thank you again for joining.
Thank you to all of you for listening to me. And if you have any questions, you can always ask Farah, and I'll, you know, we'll try to see if we can answer the questions as much as we can. Yeah, I mean, I saw there are more questions on Slido.
I know.
Is there any that I haven't answered? You know, Farah can send them to me later, and I'll try my best to answer them. Thank you very much. Have a great day.
Thank you. Have a good day, everyone. Bye.
Bye.
Thank you all. Bye. Have a good day, all.